My dear friends, I hope you all are doing good. This is Prashant Mauni and I warmly welcome all of you to Study IQ. Today is Monday. I'm sure you have enjoyed your Sunday and I believe that you are now back with a new fuel, the new energy that will help you to survive this week that is starting from today. Now, dear friends, identify the place that you can see on your screen. And regarding your last challenge, it was a building of United Nations Security Council. We know that UNSC or United Nations is a product of World War II. And there are many changes. There are many reforms that are required with this United Nations as well as United Nations Security Council too. With this, dear friends, at present, up to 35% off is being given to you on pen drive and tablet courses. StudyIQ has decided that many students were not able to avail the benefit of up to 35%, and because of many requests were coming from you, so finally you guys have persuaded us to extend this limit. So make sure you make the most out of this up to 35% now. Check out studyiq.com for more. With this, dear friends, the first item that we have, and it is of course a very important one, it is pertaining to Jammu and Kashmir and Government of India. Now the thing is, dear friends, that a couple of weeks ago we have got a special representative, right, of Government of India, and his name is Dineshwar Sharma, right, as you can see on the screen. And before sharing some important information regarding him, let me tell you that a special lecture, right, is available on our YouTube channel. I have delivered this lecture on Jammu and Kashmir and Dineshwar Sharma. It's available, of course, both in Hindi and English. So make sure you check out this lecture because you will come to know about the strength of our country. You will come to know why we were not able, or why so far this issue of Jammu and Kashmir is still in limbo. Anyways, so he is Dineshwar Sharma. He is an ex-IPS officer. He used to head, he was a chief of Information Bureau, beg your pardon, Intelligence Bureau. And he, since the inception of insurgency in Jammu and Kashmir, he has worked there. So he knows in and out about insurgency in Jammu and Kashmir. He knows how to deal with ISI, that is Inter-Service Intelligence of Pakistan. Apart from that, the contacts, or you can say, yes, contacts would be the right word here. Because imagine rather than him, if we might have, or if the Government of India might have decided to appoint a politician as a special representative, then you can understand that that person would not have that much reach as Dineshwar Sharma, because as I told you that he was an IB chief, being an IPS officer. He has been there since the inception of this insurgency, so he knows many people over there and he knows how to get things done. So during his current visit, he has met so far 24 delegations, right? This includes a youth delegation as well. And Dineshwar Sharma has termed this visit as unique, positive, fruitful and result oriented. Remember, we have to apply carrots and sticks, right? So on this side, we are engaging with all those people, right, who believe in democracy, who are ready to give up violence and join the mainstream. At the same time, all the people who are misbehaving and using violence and things like that, then you have this uniformed services who will deal with them. With this, dear friends, all these stone pelters, the youth particularly, who were been, you can say, brainwashed by all these separatist people, they are been, you can say, the sort of pardon is been granted to them, amnesty is granted to them, and this is for the first time this sort of things has taken place. And this is of course a move in confidence that we are heading towards, or this will in fact win hearts and minds of this youth, because what we want to do is, and what is right as well, that see why this separatist and other people, they exploit this youth, because youth have energy, right? And they don't care if the youth of our country. Their future is been ruined. They don't care about it. All they want is that they want to ensure that they remain in power. So by giving them, by bringing them on board, right, by meeting them, what we do is we open their eyes so that they can realize that this separatist and other people are exploiting not only their youth, but they are exploiting their life as well, right? So that's everything regarding it. The second item that we have is coming from Women and Child Development Ministry, and today's focus topic is based on Indonesia. I have kept it at the end of this lecture. Let's go through this one first. This ministry has said that minimum educational qualification for holding an office of sarpanch will be issued in near future, and this is important as well, because see, I'm not saying that if you are illiterate, right, then you don't have power of discrimination. That does not mean that if you are educated, then only then you will have power of discrimination. When I say power of discrimination, I mean what I'm trying to say is that you can identify between what is right and wrong. But the thing is, when you are holding an important office, and in our country, this office of sarpanch is a very important one, because at grassroots level, it is the sarpanch who is the head of that village. And at grassroots level, under this panchayati raj laws, right, democracy, if we are using this top-bottom approach, right, where you all the decisions are been taken by top level, you can say chief ministers or prime minister, and then things are implemented or are you can say forced down, then this way things are not going to take place, or this method does not work anymore. What we need is let the people at grassroots level decide what is good for them, what is bad for them, right? Let them take their own decisions, and that's how it should be, right? We should have democracy at all different stages. So this is the main theme, or you can say the philosophy behind this Panchayati Raj laws, and Sarpanch plays a very important role here. And if the Sarpanch is educated, at least 12th, if he or she has completed his 12th standard, then you can easily say that that person can read and write. So it will add, you can say, more efficiency and effectiveness in managing a village or that gram panchayat, right? So you can have best of both. You can have your own experiences as well as a touch of education will be beneficial for all the people in the village, and this will encourage women as well. So from now on or from near future, if a woman wants to, any lady, if she wants to get elected as a sarpanch, then she should complete at least her 12th standard. With this, dear friends, the president had a meeting with medical officers of Central Health Service, and we have seen that many a times. We have discussed about this thing, that you see that IAS trainees, they do meet president, then you have IPS and IFS and other services people as well do meet president, and that's how it works, right? It is part of their training. So this, during this interaction, we find that president will share some thoughts, or he will speak something about the things that are going on pertaining to that particular service. Here he is talking about health, and he said he has stressed the need to tackle communicable as well as non-communicable diseases in our country. Now we have a very fine example here to tackle communicable diseases, right? What we are doing is we have launched this Mission Indradhanush. And it is a proactive step. You immunize our children as well as pregnant ladies. And with this way, we can control many communicable diseases, which are also killing many, or they are one of the reasons behind so many deaths taking place in our country. The second one is non-communicable diseases, and we will talk about it in detail. But before that, I would like to add here that President has talked about this effective governance as the at the community, village and district level, and we know it very well that in our country the scenario is that most of the doctors are living in urban area, and there is a gap in rural area when it comes to health services. And what happens actually is that when you are at a very initial stage, or say for example first stage of any disease, and if you don't get this medical treatment at a rural area or in villages or in small towns, then this disease will take a sort of severe form, and by time you reach this urban area, things would have got out of the hand. Many times this sort of things are seen, and so of course we need to ensure that this primary healthcare system is available in a rural area as well. Now we're coming back to this non-communicable diseases, and you have four major categories. You have CVs, that is cardiovasculars, you have diabetes, chronic respiratory diseases, and then you have this cancer. Now dear friends, I would like to share something regarding it. I'm sure you know that it is all these diseases, right? This CV or blood pressure thing and diabetes and other things are associated with our lifestyle. Nowadays we know that technology has made our life a little bit too much luxurious, and because of this thing we are not even doing a simple walk and things like that. Now why it is not a sort of advice at all, right? This is a technology that through with which I would like you guys to be a bit familiar. Now see dear friends, of course you know the importance of exercise, it keeps you healthy and things like that, right? But if you see its impact on your education as well with your studies, do give it a try. Do some sort of exercise. And when I'm saying exercise, I'm not saying that you should only work out in a gym. Why I'm saying this thing is because most of the time we feel that if I join this gym and that gym, then only I would be able to be in shape and things like that. Not at all, dear friends. All sorts of physical activities, you can do anything you like. You can just climb stairs, and even when you are on a break, study break, then you can do a little bit of workout, whatever you like. It's not necessary at all that you have to go to gym. But that does not mean that you don't do any sort of exercise at all. Our country is blessed with the natural weather that you can step out of your home and take a walk. But if you go to many other countries, you don't get, particularly those countries that are having a very severe cold and rainfall all the day. So over that, in those countries, you need a gym and a sort of indoor setup to do exercise. And do give it a try, and it will help you a lot with your preparation as well. Because remember, if you are active physically, then your mind will, it is the mind and body, basically they work in sync with each other. And for those of you who cannot go out for whatever reason, you can do some household work as well, and this will give you a sort of a physical flexibility and exercise. So that's not an advice, it is a technology, as I told you. With this, dear friends, Ministry of External Affairs and Home Ministry, India and Russia have signed two agreements. We have talked about it a couple of days ago. This first one is pertaining to terrorism, and second one is pertaining to narcotics. And you can understand that both this terrorism and narcotics are associated with each other. The more money you can make by selling all these banned substances, that money can be used after this terrorist activities and things like that. And with the signing of this agreement, this agreement will provide a legal framework for bilateral cooperation in this field. With this, dear friends, this is Russia here. Do spend some quality time after it. You can see Arctic Circle here. You can see part of Russia is in Europe as well. Ural Mountains, you will find it somewhere here. Apart from that, you will see that it is not that far from USA, right? Bering Strait is separating these two rivals, you can say. And there are many other countries as well that are sharing border with Russia. It is the biggest country in the world in terms of land. So, and you know that India and Russia are very good and dear friends, or you can say strategic friends. We are not that close at present, or not that relationship is not that cordial at present. Anyways, this is Russia here, and there is a thing called International North-South Transport Corridor, and this will connect India with Russia, and Chabahar port plays a very important role in connecting Russia and India. With this, dear friends, let's go through our focus topic, and it is pertaining to Bali's Mount Agung. And Bali is an island of Indonesia. Indonesia is world's biggest archipelago. That means it is made up of many different islands, and nearly 17,000 islands make this Indonesia. 17,000 plus islands are there in Indonesia. So you can imagine there are different islands in Indonesia. And dear friends, at present the thing is this Agung Mountain, right? It was you can say rumbling, not severe rumbling, but there were some sort of warning shots were been fired by this Agung Mountain in September. And I remember very well that in that PIB we have discussed about in September's PIB we have discussed about this Agung Mountain. And today for regular listeners it would be a revision for you. Of course I have added some new things in it as well. So at present, dark smoke and ash is coming out from this Agung Mountain, and airports are closed. Thousands of tourists are stranded here in this place in Bali. And remember that any sort of this is of course a natural way for the earth to balance itself, but it will add huge amount of carbon dioxide or different sort of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, and this will be visible. Its impact will be visible in the global environment as well. In future, whenever we find any sort of research material or research work on this thing, then we'll discuss about it, of course. So here is Indonesia, as you can see here. So many islands are here, and this is the place here where things are going on. This is Bali here. And dear friends, with this, I would also like to mention here that go through this Strait of Malacca and Makassar Strait, and this you have Java Sea and Banda Sea and all these things, right? Do spend some time after it. And this is a zoomed map of this Bali. This is Mount Agung, as you can see here. And it was in 1963. You see this area was affected, and at present this 10 kilometer radius area is declared as sort of exclusive zone, so you are not allowed to go here. And this is all these things are taking place here. And one of the reason why you have this many islands here in Indonesia is because of it is located on Pacific ring of fire, and this ring of fire is a place where a maximum amount of earthquakes and all these volcanic mountains and things like that are located here. And one of the main reason why you get volcano and this sort of things is because of divergence of the plate. So two plates are moving away from each other. This creates a hole, or this creates a sort of gap for this pressurized lava to come out. So that's basically everything about it, dear friends. Today yesterday's answers are here. Not yesterday, Saturday's answers are here. Ashwa Ghosh, Nagarjun and Vasumitra. So the right answer is 1, 2 and 3. That is option D. And Muhammad Ali Jinnah is associated with the Green Book. Today's question, who among the following had repealed the Vernacular Press Act? Lord Lytton, Lord Ripon, Lord Dufferin or Lord Lansdowne? And which is the longest river? A. Amazon, B. Lena, C. Amur and D. Congo. And third question and the last one is, the Supreme Court was set up by A. Regulating Act 1973, Pitts India Act 1784, Charter Act 1813 or Charter Act 1833. I end this discussion here, dear friends. Don't forget to make the maximum out of this, up to 35% off. And subscribe, share, like, pass your valuable comments and answer. I'm ending. I'll see you all soon. Till then, enjoy your studies. Jai Hind.